Раз-раз. Шановні колеги, доброго дня. Дякуємо, що завітали наш захід.
Dear colleagues, good afternoon. Thank you for coming to our briefing today. The Center for Legal and Policy Reforms and the DEJURE Foundation present our report. This event on renewal of the legal power, the judiciary, we waited for it for a long time, and the new institution we hoped would be created. Unfortunately, we saw that much was in this process which was inconsistent with our hopes. At the same time, during last year when the competition was held, there was very many opinions whether it was fair or not, whether there were violations or there were not, and whether the compliance with the law was observed. And we saw that there is no joint opinion and there is no one place where we can read this. So as experts, we decided to take this role to assess whether the competition was fair and transparent, whether it provided the results which were expected. And we as the public were rather critical, and we called on Ukrainian regime, Ukrainian leadership and civil society to make an audit of the competition of the selection to the Supreme Court, not in terms of compliance to the European Council standards which were created in other countries, not in Ukraine, we assess not the compliance to those standards, but the compliance with our hopes, whether it meets our hopes. Unfortunately, Ukrainian leadership and you have not conducted such assessment so far. I will not be talking much. I will give the floor to Roman Kuibida, the head of the board, Center of Political and Legal Reforms, who has contributed the lion's share to compiling this report. So what are the main lessons in this report? Here we see two achievements and 12 failures. Thank you, Mykhailo, for your introduction. As concerns the selection competition, there were many different messages, and we decided to tell whether this competition was an excellent one or it has some shortcomings. We did that not to look into the past, but to look into the future, because according to the procedures of qualification assessment, eligibility assessment, the assessment, the vetting will be conducted for sitting judges, and the competitions to the higher courts will be based on this eligibility criteria and this assessment procedure. What we saw, unfortunately, we found more than 20 facts demonstrating that the competition was not transparent and fair, not only the competition, but the selection also as well. The Higher Qualification Commission of Judges conducted it, and the matters were considered also in the Higher Council of Justice. And why we decided that the competition was not transparent and unprecedented, it was the fact that the interviews with candidates were broadcast, but the assessment was not transparent. We hardly find the correlation with that what people watched, what they saw, and the results, the scores given to the candidates and the public also do not understand. It is incomprehensible why high scores were given to some candidates and low to the other candidates, because it doesn't correlate with the results of psychological tests and practical assignments and test results. At the same time, we found the first alarming signal was during the practical test. One of the practical assignments was in fact a copy of a case considered by some candidates while sitting judges. So this was the advantages which those judges got, because they needed less time to complete practical assignments, because they were identical to those court cases which they adjudicated. So if we look into the deviations during the competition, this or that way they brought to the Supreme Court this or that candidate, individual candidate who were allowed to hold the office in the Supreme Court. So this was in compliance with the methodology, and there were manipulations with the scores. Three candidates, thanks to these manipulations, have become the judges of the new Supreme Court. Problematic was also the application of the tests for loyalty of candidates. According to the description of the test, loyalty of candidates was assessed to the leadership and to the standards, corporate rules, which exist in this community of judges. And if they have such practices as mutual cover-up, then maybe these tests were used to reject those persons who are ready to change the system and its inadequate rules. There were rather many cases of conflict of interest. I think Mykhailo will tell more about this. As concerns the integrity, me and Mykhailo are members of the Public Integrity Council, so we'll tell about the findings of the PIC, how they were considered by the commission. Borys Malyshev, an independent expert, will tell more about the text of our research. You can download from the Foundation DEJURE and the Center of Policy and Legal Reforms websites, and there is also the translation into English available for download there. Thank you, Roman. I'm given the floor. As a moderator, I would like to say that we have two myths about this competition. The first is unprecedented transparency. Partially, this is true, because before that, no video broadcasts on YouTube were present, but were in place. But and also dossiers are available on websites, and the Public Integrity Council took part in the assessment. All this The requirements of the law have not been complied with until NGOs reminded and made rallies so that the High Qualification Commission comply with these indicators. We can say that there were many, 27 judges of the Supreme Court were appointed, and the opinions of PIC were negative, but the number of candidates is far higher. More than 60% have either negative opinions of the PIC or the information, negative information that the High Qualification Commission of Judges have not verified. I would like to give the floor to Borys Malyshev so that he tell about his opinion. Borys, you are welcome. Thank you, Mykhailo. Good afternoon. The subject of my analysis was the opinion of the PICs about the candidates who High Qualification Commission of Judges and the High Council of Justice selected and the President of Ukraine appointed. I analyzed the findings in details and made conclusions about the High Qualification Commission's decisions where the opinions of PICs were not supported, were overruled, and when High Qualification Commissions allowed the candidates rejected by Public Integrity Council to move forward to pass to further stages of the selection procedure, this demonstrates the well-grounded doubts in fairness of the process. They were found sometimes in untrue facts about the assets or property of candidates, or lacking information or unproven information about the integrity of the candidates which the candidates provided, participation of the candidates in the court trials where the decisions were made, which were criticized by the European Court of Human Rights, when such decisions, such judgments were named as those violating the European Convention on Human Rights. Participation of the candidate or his actions in the court trials were these trials prevent either the parties to exercise their rights or the journalists to conduct coverage of those trials. All this is registered either by video footage or in statements of the journalists of the parties to the trials, to law enforcement bodies and other authorities, and other facts were present in the PIC opinions testifying that this candidate is either not integral or there are some claims or doubts in his integrity. When negative opinions of PIC, how they were considered by the High Qualification Commissions, I analyzed in detail every decision of the High Qualification Commission. What were the grounds of the PIC opinions? All comments are approved in PAC opinions, and the High Qualification Commission provide first the full findings of the PAC, the second part the full explanation of the candidate, and the third part is just one paragraph that the High Qualifications Commission deemed the candidate integral, but why he is integral, it is not explained. So the main complaint, the main claim is that there is no opinion of HQC. The declaration of PSCs present in this decision of HQC, and also the position of the candidate, but there is no opinion of the commission indicated. So the explanations of the candidate, they overrule the decision of the findings of PSC. The no documents are in practice were requested by High Qualifications Commissions in order to prove or reject the findings of PSC. In some cases, there is analysis of some documents provided by the candidate himself. So it seemed that High Qualification Commissions made deliberate decisions to the benefit of the candidates, being an opponent to the Public Integrity Council, also the law on judiciary, it says that the PAC facilitates to the High Qualifications Commission of Judges in exercising its functions of assessing the moral and integral qualities of the candidates. So they should be one group, one team, the commission and the council. And if the High Qualification Commission doubts in some information which are presented in the negative opinion of the Public Integrity Council, it should prove why this opinion is refuted and not taken into consideration, but the High Qualification Commission decisions does not state its reasons, its explanations why this decision was made. I think this is fundamentally wrong position of the High Qualification Commission, which does not facilitate assessment of integrity of the candidates, and of course it results in the confrontation between the High Qualifications Commission of Judges and the Public Integrity Council, and is of negative effect on the selection and as a result on the public trust into the results of the selection process. When negative opinions were provided by the Public Integrity Council, the High Qualification Commission just agreed to the candidates' explanations and overruled the negative decisions of the Public Integrity Council, and that's all. Some theses of summarizing nature as to shortcomings in these practices of the High Qualification Commission of Judges are presented in our report, so everyone can find them there for more details. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Borys. I would like to say several words. So what I wanted to say, So we have more than 100 points and 11 drawbacks among them that are really serious. And this contest, we cannot call it a contest. So if we are speaking about impartial and fair competition, this competition had a lot in its form, but not so much in its essence. And if we ask whether we had such competition, I would say no, we didn't have it. So as we've said, there were many violations at the stage of the admission and the selection stage and during practical tasks, tests, and at the level of interviews. 790 out of 1,000. So this scores were provided for the interview. So what we got in the result, they say a lot that we shouldn't assess some violations because no one is ideal. Let's look at the first decision of this Supreme Court. The first decision was taken in the first days of its work, starting 15 December last year. These first decisions were about the appointment of the heads of the new court, and they have shown that these candidates, who are the judges of the Supreme Court, and so whether they are able to provide changes. So they elected head, deputy head, and cassation court courts heads, and also the head of the Grand Chamber, and all except the head of the court were before the heads of the cassation courts or other courts in the old court system of Ukraine that has the lowest level of trust. Bogdan Lvov have negative opinion from the PIC, and I remind to you that this is the judge who couldn't explain where he got the collection of watches, and also he has several other drawback. So also he was elected as the head of a cassation court, and also judges elected him deputy head of the Supreme Council, and I won't go into detail about other appointments. And they are similar in their nature. So it shows that these judges of the Supreme Court, it shows that many didn't vote for these candidates, and they are not why it happened so. There are two reasons for this. First one is the order of formation of High Qualification Commission and the procedure according to which these judges were selected.
Who select the judges? Who is responsible for the selection and for the appointment of the judges? 10 members out of 15 were elected by the judges themselves. So the reform, which the main part is to renew judges community, the judges core, which should incorporate the civil society opinion. But in fact, the old judges elect the selection commission, the competition commission, and that's why this commission is biased to the candidates And it is biased to the opinions of the Public Integrity Council, which it overruled. 6 of 15 members, at least, were judges. 6 members of the High Qualification Commissions, they were blamed by Euromaidan. There were claims against them about Euromaidan events. One of them, Mr. Vasilenko, he was a participant in the cases banning peaceful associations and meetings of the citizens, and one of the members has the collection of pots for 1,000 hryvnias worth. So they had conflicts of interest when they issued decisions about similar actions as they did when they selected the members to the Supreme Court. Mr. Volochko, the conviction against him is already in the court when he took $1,000 amount, which was qualified not as a bribe but as a fraud, because he did not handed over this bribe to the addressees. That's why this is fraud. Mr. Panadasyuk, the head of the Council of Justice, they received some weaponry from the president, which is directly banned to Panadasyuk, because as a judge he can't get any decorations from the president, and he could not explain when he stopped to be the citizen of the Russian Federation, because he was the judge in the Russian Federation, and he recognized that he was the judge of the Russian Federation and of Ukraine simultaneously during the same period. So when he stopped to be the citizen of Russia, we do not know. But according to the Constitution, only one citizenship is allowed. And the other member, Ms. Malashenkova, the other member of the High Council of Justice, the other members also were given the state decorations. We can't talk about their political neutrality, and we can prolong this list. The members of this high bodies, they do not want to clean the judges' corpse. This was the reason why many candidates who were appointed to the Supreme Court, they were politically engaged and politically selected. We can't talk about further efficient reform of judiciary if we continue to delegate the cleaning of the judges, the vetting of the judges to politically dependent persons. We will not have efficient reform of judiciary. The second is the procedure, the selection procedure, the rules of selection of candidates. Transparency rules were implemented partially. They were complied partially when the High Council of Justice, they sometimes were for the candidates against whom the Council of Europe was. And who were not capable to explain where they get their assets from. So the procedure should be changed, including because the law in, delegated too much discretion in decision making to the members of the High Qualification Commission of Judges on how to select the judges. They approve the methodology, they conduct interviews, they assess the results of psychological tests and form the final list, upon short list. And so we should understand how they voted, who gave what scores, and the criteria should be transparent and understandable to the society. And the validity should be checked of the tests and the results of assessment to the status quo. If this is not changed, we cannot talk about efficient reform in future. One more aspect is also important. Why it is important to be changed today? Because one of the important stages of judiciary reform and anti-corruption reform is formation of the higher anti-corruption court. We have Ms. Anastasiya Krasnosilska with us today. She is an advocacy of the Center of Anti-Corruption Action. Thank you, Mykhailo. The President of Ukraine and his bill on anti-corruption court proposes to create the anti-corruption court in the old fashioned, to form an anti-corruption court the same way as the Supreme Court was elected. Using this approach, there is no prospects to have independent and new anti-corruption court is zero perspective. We will have only the title, but not the court. The Higher Qualification Commission will select the judges to the anti-corruption court the same way. There will be the public council of international experts instead of public integrity council, but at the same time, the High Qualification Commissions can ignore again the opinions of this public council, and it will again could not could be allowed not to explain its decisions, and it is already ready to ignore the opinions of public council, which is not even elected. It has changed its regulations, and it is now allowed even not to consider the public council's opinions. If there are no proofs, what is reliable proofs in the understanding of High Qualification Commission? This is, for example, the judgment of the court or the Corruption Prevention Agency's opinion. I would not comment on the quality of the Corruption Prevention Agency. It is a very political politically engaged agency and the judgments on the corruption and unethical behavior of judges are lacking in the country. So if High Qualification Commission wants to reject candidates only based on the court judgment, there is no reason to talk about trust. This consultative public counsel in the anti-corruption court candidate selection would have the same weight as public integrity counsel in the selection of judges to the Supreme Court. What could be done? We should have public council of international experts, or they should play the principal crucial role. The Venice Commission, which analyzed this matter, which analyzed the anti-corruption court establishment, the international experts nominated by international donors should become temporary members of the High Qualification Commission of Judges, and at this level participate in decision making on the candidates and the according to international standards, this is acceptable option. And or the other option is to give them crucial role in filtering, rejecting the candidates which are inconsistent with the eligibility requirements. International experts are said to be against the sovereignty of Ukraine, that some people from other countries will come and appoint the judges to Ukraine. This is not true. This would not threaten or jeopardize the sovereignty principle. Venice Commission said no. They took part at the first stage. This is not final decision. After them, based on their positions, the High Qualifications Commission and the High Council of Justice will continue the selection, and the President of Ukraine will appoint the judges. So three sovereign institutions, as in all international standards as foreseen, are involved in the process of selection. So the only way for the only steps which we should do, not to talk in 1 year period about the unfair and non-transparent selection of judges to the anti-corruption court, we should give to the international experts the same rights as the Ukrainian experts in the selection competition, or we should allow them to become members, temporary members of High Qualifications Commission. Thank you, Anastasiya. To sum up, we would like to remind you that the DEJURE Foundation and the Center for Policy and Legal Reform websites, our report is available in full, and we will disseminate among the journalists who received the press announcements from us. We will send you the full version of our report. And now I would like to give the floor for the round of questions and answers. We have no questions. I have one question.
Судячи з всіх деталей, які ви сьогодні нам нагадали, для когось може розкрили, чи можемо ми ще якось вплинути на ту картину, яку ми вже маємо, чи лише в перспективі, щоб не повторились от подібні ситуації в майбутньому? Тобто що об'єктивно зараз можна ще якось зробити, якщо можна?
Дякую за запитання. Я почну, можливо, колеги продовжать. В Верховному суді на сьогодні призначено 117 суддів. Закон каже про те, що до 200 суддів може бути в Верховному суді. Ми також чули від відповідальних органів, зокрема від Вищої кваліфікаційної комісії суддів, що вони планують добрати ще в цьому році суддів до Верховного суду. Тобто це є шанс, але це одночасно є і загроза. Чому? Тому що якщо ще 83 судді будуть добрані за тими самими правилами, це явно буде не краще, ніж було до того. Тому що правила порівняно з тим, що було, на сьогодні навіть погіршилися, враховуючи те, що сказала Анастасія. Дійсно, Вища кваліфікаційна комісія суддів внесла зміни до регламенту, де сказала, що може навіть не розглядати висновки Громадської ради доброчесності, якщо не буде посилань на ті самі українські суди, які ми, власне, і намагаємося реформувати. Друге, це чому це можливість? Це, по-перше, можливість, якщо ми змінимо підходи до формування, до відбору суддів, все-таки мати кращий склад Верховного суду, ніж той, який є на сьогодні. По-друге, це можливість також сформувати і добрати суддів до спеціалізованої антикорупційної палати в Верховний суд, яка має стати касаційною інстанцією в розгляді, фактично касаційним антикорупційним судом. Я особисто не уявляю, яким чином, навіть уявімо, станеться диво, і ми відберемо дуже незалежних, дуже професійних суддів перших двох інстанцій антикорупційного суду. Я не уявляю, яким чином цей Верховний суд, ця палата в кримінальних справах чи кримінальний касаційний суд буде переглядати ці рішення. Це, на жаль, в такому випадку ми повторимо досвід сумний наших сусідів Словаччини, яка створила антикорупційний суд на першій інстанції, а в другий Верховний суд повністю поскасовував дуже багато цих рішень. На сьогодні, на жаль, ця інституція саме через ці причини не є ефективною. Тому, звичайно, при доборі, в другому етапі доборі суддів як антикорупційного суду, так і Верховного суду потрібно змінювати як процедури, так і тих, хто призначає цих суддів, а не віддавати все в руки тої дискредитованої вже Вищої кваліфікаційної комісії суддів, яка є на сьогодні.
Уточніть, будь ласка, ось ці зміни, вони поки що на етапі наполегливих пропозицій громадських експертів, чи вже є якісь конкретні пропозиції і десь починається якийсь рух, якесь лобіювання за такі зміни?
Громадські організації вже почали працювати, вже працюють над тим, щоб запропонувати конкретні зміни. До того, навіть в процесі конкурсу, щоб був зареєстрований законопроект 6363, який робить конкурс набагато прозорішим. Але ми зараз вже побачили, що ситуація є, проблеми є набагато ширші, як відображено в звіті, і потрібно змінювати в цілому як органи суддівського урядування, так і процедури добору. Анастасія, в контексті антикорупційного суду, що можна ще зробити?
Власне, по антикорупційному суду в парламенті законопроект президента 7440, і, на жаль, він не враховує жодного із зауважень по процедурі добору суддів до Верховного суду, і в такому вигляді, в якому він є, його ухвалення лише принесе нам через рік чергове розчарування суддями антикорупційного суду. Президент обіцяє, що його законопроект може бути поправлений до другого читання. Ми, звичайно, хочемо йому вірити. Ціна питання дуже висока, адже умовою отримання наступного траншу Міжнародного валютного фонду, необхідного для стабілізації гривні, є ухвалення законопроекту про антикорупційний суд з визначальною роллю міжнародних експертів. Міжнародний валютний фонд вже сказав, що, простіше кажучи, за такий законопроект, який зараз є в парламенті, наступного траншу не буде.
І, на жаль, хотілося б, на щастя, є увага преси та тих, хто займається судовою реформою до цього процесу, за що ми вам дякуємо. Хотілося б закликати якнайбільше піднімати цю тему і звертати на неї увагу. Чому? Тому що президент України, який є відповідальним за судову реформу, на жаль, поки що не чує і не хоче чути і бачити цих проблем, тому що, зокрема, в Давосі він уже сказав про те, що ми взагалі завершили судову реформу. Багато разів в процесі відбору і в результаті до Верховного суду він сказав про те, що це був безпрецедентний конкурс, і кандидати, які щодо яких були претензії громадськості, вони взагалі не потрапили туди. Тому я не знаю, з яких причин, чи президент не бачить і не чує, чи не хоче бачити і не хоче чути. Потрібно про це говорити, про ті недоліки, їх висвітлювати, для того, щоб ми все-таки їх поправили. Ми, чесно скажу, відверто, дуже хочемо успіху президента і успіху країни в реформуванні судової влади. На жаль, поки що цих успіхів дуже мало.
Хотілося б запитати вас сьогодні, Микола Марченко, Асоціація українських правників, хотілося б запитати вас про такі, вашу точку зору на те, як потрібно все ж таки інституціоналізувати участь громадськості в процесі відбору суддів, для, причому не тільки антикорупційного суду і Верховного суду, а загалом. Чи підтримуєте ви на сьогоднішній день впровадження доктрини делегованих повноважень для реформування громадської ради доброчесності? І чи вважаєте ви за необхідним на законодавчому рівні включення членів громадських організацій до складу Вищої ради правосуддя, як обов'язкових членів, для того, щоб вони, як Литві, могли впливати на прийняття рішення, а не лише давати рекомендації для Вищої ради правосуддя про призначення суддів?
Дякую, Микола, за слушне запитання. Колеги, хтось? Романе?
Я думаю, що коли закладали модель спільної участі у формуванні
When the model of joint participation of NGOs, public and judges, community, lawyers and scholars, the society saw that there will be team play between the three groups, but they demonstrated that there is big gap between those who represent the judges' core, the judges' community, and the civil society. So the model as it is did not contribute anything good. The judges and their bodies, they ignored everything what was provided by the Public Integrity Council. The changes are possible in two aspects. Either NGOs representatives will be included because they are active and they care about the reform, so they should be included into the membership of the commissions of the bodies which are responsible for selection. The other option is not to give consultative powers, just powers to present their opinions, but to make their opinions binding. If civil society will say is saying no, then the candidate should be rejected and not to become the judge. Very short sentence. This participation of Ukrainian civil society experts does not replace the participation of international experts, because the national experts without international experts model is weaker because not all NGOs are useful. It is very easy to create the NGO and to bring its members into some Public Integrity Council. This we already saw in practice. Unfortunately, this was politically influenced representatives. That's why we insisted on international donors' participation. This would prevent acceptance of those candidates who are in fact are puppets of the presidential administration. This is not about the Public Integral Council. We were very satisfied with the composition of the Public Integrity Council, but it should be reformatted upon some time, and I expect that the administration of President would try to influence this process to have more loyal members of the Public Integrity Council who would not make high coverage in mass media that the opinions were rejected. My opinion is that the optimum way is to strengthen the legislative role of the Public Integrity Council, to give more powers to this Public Integrity Council in its relations with High Qualifications Commission of Judges, and introduce into the law the more complex procedure to refute the opinions of Public Integrity Council. But I would like also to support the opinion we heard today. Maybe the selection of members of Public Integrity Council should be strengthened include into this procedure such a stage as recommendations of international partners and donors and representatives of international institutions to Ukraine, which are involved in human rights advocacy and rule of law and anti-corruption initiatives assistance. Thank you, dear guests. Unfortunately, our time is over, so thank you for your very interesting presentations and thank you for your attention.